George. I'm the founder of Chris Farms. It's been running as it is, I guess, for about 3 years now. It started, I was living in the 3rd Ward near the Magnolia Projects on Amelia and Ferret, and I had a space about 8 by 16 feet filled with trash and needles and all kinds of garbage that I took, and I just started cleaning it up, and I started adding soil, and I was getting free juice pulp and leaves and just different things the city had to provide. And as I was doing that, I started making a little worm bin as well. I kept the worm bin under the house, and kids would come by and see me working, and then they'd have a cousin around, they'd tell that cousin to come by and come look at Mr. Zach's worms, and they would help me, and we would be growing stuff together, and I'd send them home with squash, cucumbers, whatever it was. And then days later, they would come back and say, hey, they'd give me some red beans or they'd give me some fried fish and say, my mom wanted you to have this. And it started a community, if you will. I got to know everybody in the neighborhood. People got to know me. It became a gathering point. And that was a very small spot. So I wanted to do something on a bigger scale. I also wanted to buy a house, but before I even owned it, I went and planted sunflower seeds all throughout it. The sunflower seeds started coming up. Right as they were coming up, a man was shot at the Family Dollar right there on up the street on St. Claude. And so there was a SWAT team running through the neighborhood, and they were going all through my yard, and all the sunflowers were trampled by the SWAT team. So this was kind of my introduction to the neighborhood. CRISP stands for Community Research into Sustainable Permaculture. People always hear Chris for some reason, the boy's name when I'm saying it, I don't know why. So that presents an issue. However, even the sustainable part is sort of redundant, but without it, we're CRIP Farms, which we already have enough issues in this neighborhood without being referred to as CRIPs. So permaculture, all permaculture is sustainable. Permaculture is essentially, in my idea, making the most out of the resources you have, using what you have, making sure everything has more than one purpose, leaving the land better off than before you work the land, if you will. Diversity, bringing all kinds of things together so that they work in communion with one another, rather than a monoculture of corn, where you see everything as just, you know, it's not like nature. Permaculture is permanent culture, for lack of a better word. It's been going on for years before us. It was just coined by a man named Bill Mollison, and others have followed the path. It works in zones, where the zone one is the closest to your house, if you will. It's where you might have your kitchen garden, your herbs, the things you use every day. And it spreads out from this point to zone two. It needs a little bit less care. Zone three needs a little bit less care. What I would like to see CRISP, just the area where I live, as zone one, and the neighborhood where I live expanding out into zone two, zone three, and further. That's kind of the ultimate goal, is to have.
Chuk chuk.
So early on, when Chris first started, we built a bunch of boxes because that's what we saw. We're using 2x6s, 2x4s, found wood that we'd scavenged throughout the city. It's plentiful in New Orleans. And we'd do lettuce, bok choy, kale, collards, mostly annual crops that needed water every day. And early on, Sneaky Pickle was just opening up, and we would roll over there with a laundry basket full of produce, and we'd sell them that for $30. And it became something where it was not easy to sustain what a restaurant might need. It wasn't ever something to be a business for me, but I felt somewhat responsible because Patrick was putting in so many hours that we needed to try to find a way to make some money out of this. And I think it's changed from that beginning to my goal now is to bring in the most, the greatest ecosystem I can, if you will, and to have mostly perennial things that do not need much care, that will take care of themselves and have a broad array of different things. And if some stuff is sold here and there, that's fine. That will go straight toward paying kids. But we have pomegranate trees, we have mulberry trees, persimmons, planted a couple of papayas recently. There are muscadines there. We've taken the wild 9thward chickens and cooped some of them up so we can get their eggs. But there's not enough where we're going to be going and selling to a big restaurant or anything like that, nor do I think that's what I'm interested in. Gwen used to come by on a weekday and it would be 10 o'clock in the morning. And Patrick and I would be out in the yard and he would roll up on his bike, and I don't think he had his little dog Crack back then, but he would come and, "All right, hey, what y'all doing?" And he helped Patrick build the tables out back that we have all the starts on, where we move our plants from the greenhouse to the first time outside before they go in the ground. And he's one of those kids that magnetic almost. His smile, he's very happy, he's a very charming and just a nice, good kid. And he raps, and he can actually rap all right.
He's squashed about that big, like that long. All right.
We just upsize these.
We're taking these into the little 4-inch pots, into these same things.
All right.
All right.
He knew stuff. He knew more than most of the other people who would come around claiming that they are gardeners or they're growers, and he learned that picking it up through Patrick and myself. And there was a guy, I'm pretty sure, was sitting waiting to buy some weed from him or something. It was just stuck there while Quinn was working, and he was on the clock, quote unquote. We had gotten him. He'd been volunteering for about 2 years, and then we started trying to pay him $10 an hour whenever we could. And so he's talking to the other guy, and the guy asks him, what's he doing? And out of nowhere, Quinn says, "Oh, this is a malakia. It's an Egyptian spinach." And I had no idea that he even knew that.
My name is Quinn, and I work for Crest Farms, Mr. Zach. And basically what we do is we grow as much plants as we can to help people know that is always a good way to grow food yourself and to have people in the community interact with each other and have a good time instead of, like, you know, in New Orleans they have a lot of violence and stuff. So we have a way where we can have everybody in the community get together and do something that they like, you know, and don't get into any problems. So every year we had a 9thward festival where we have different people, all races, come and we all have a good time, party, fun, build crawfish, music, you know, just enjoy ourselves and admire the plants and how far we don't come with our garden. And some people that come by, they love it. They love the different plants we have, like how we grow pork chop, and some people don't even eat that, but once we experience them and let them taste it, they love it. And shiso and all of it, different fruits and vegetables we have. And people just admire the things we do for the community.
No, it goes like this. I got my hole digging rose. You don't know what I know here on Chris Farms. You gotta be in the rose.
We have volunteers come from Parkway Partners. They sent a group of volunteers and we had some extras. So we sent them over to the lot beside Quinn's house, which was right over there on Lesseps and Villery. And they helped Quinn to design some little keyhole patterns and bricks. And so it became where there was a sense of ownership, where this is my garden. And then what happened is his stepdad, Sydney, mowed over all of that. But he was working on wanting to do something at his grandma's in the lower 9thward. And yeah.
And they got a big old deep bump that's gonna mess up the back of your car.
Yeah,
and stuff like that.
My car is clunked a couple times.
And they got it all around New Orleans. Like, I like working with the volunteers because every person is different. And some people might not know a little bit about gardening, they just want to learn. So that's why I come in. I can teach them something they don't know. And at the same time, I can learn something from them. And like, I probably never been where they're from. So they could tell me things about where they've been. And I can tell them things about where I've been. And it's just a new learning experience. I can learn from them and they can learn from me. Now you say you're from New York, right?
Yeah.
How's life in the big city?
It's not from the big city. I'm from Albany, which is the capital.
Okay.
Which is the capital because New York City can't be bothered being the capital. It's got too much stuff going on.
You know, there may still be crimes committed. There may still be people who go to jail. There may be all of these things probably are still going to happen. But what I'd like to do is something where down the road, somebody can remember, I helped to plant this. I helped to grow this. Or they, you know, who knows? Quinn may be God knows where someday and showing somebody, this is how you tease roots. This is what you do. You take it out of the plug tray and you separate them. And to see somebody teaching somebody else, to even when I'm over in the lot on France Street, even when the people were out there selling dope left and right, running in and out of the abandoned houses, there were still times when some of those guys were walking around the garden showing people things, saying, you see this moringa? This is the healthiest leaf in the world. And you know, over here, we got, these are Tabasco peppers, and over here we got borage, and you know, we don't use any pesticides, we don't use no GHB. Now, what they meant was we don't use any GMOs, but it was close, and there was a sense of pride in a garden that they weren't even necessarily working in, but it became theirs. They called it the park. We're going to hang out at the park. And that place would still be open were it not for the other neighbors that I really respect. I mean, it's hard to bring children and other kids into a garden when people are selling dope and when, you know, people are getting shot right outside the garden, which happened 2 hours ago. You know, Michael, my neighbor down the street, has found a gun in the woodpile. I found a box of needles. Yet at the same time, there has to be the notion that this is still a human being. And that's I think, what we have. That's the best I can hope for, is to share moments with other human beings. I think we all have in common this desire not to suffer. And because of that, we do different things for different reasons. So who am I to judge?
Everybody in the community have a chicken coop where eggs and dough. Instead of them going buy fresh eggs from the store, they always have fresh eggs in their chicken coop. Whereas that's less money they have to spend, but more community work put together, you know? Like, Mr. Zach, I first met Mr. Zach with this garden here. And when I met him, I actually started my own garden down the street, but we moved. And as time progressed, the garden became bigger and we built the 9thward Festival and more people started to come out, more people started to help. And then Mr. Zach invested in the other property across the street, and like more younger kids and kids that was in and out of jail, they'll come and they'll be like, y'all need help with anything, and they'll come help us plant stuff. And like even the older people who do wrong stuff, you know, they come and help. They help us spread mulch, plant plants, and they help others. And it just helps other people think that there's a better way of doing things than what we do, you know.
You knew that there was other stuff going on. You knew, and it just kind of wasn't talked about. I'm not the type who's going to go and say to a kid, you need to get your shit together, man. If you don't do this, you're going to end up in jail, blah, 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 blah. I'm there to just work alongside you and let you know I'm here for you. And I'm going to be here for you now. I don't know what's going to happen. You know, one day we're out in the garden, we're planting seeds, and we're doing starts, and we're working with a bunch of white kids from Pennsylvania. And the next day I get a call from Bernard across the street who says, hey, I think the little dude got arrested. And I see the article, and sure enough, carjacking, other kid has a gun, they had told somebody to get on the ground. And I just see this kid that's so full of life and just screwed. And I think of it as, you know, when I'm a kid and somebody says, hey, why don't we go and let's jump off this bridge into the water? And they dare me to do a backflip. And I'm going to do it because I'm not scared, or I'm at least not going to let them know I'm scared. And so I do that backflip and I land on my back and I got red marks all over. It's the same thing, just at a different level. Yet now, he's stuck in OPP. And I've been in OPP. It's not a nice place. And it's not a place where, you know, they want to hear much about you talking about gardening. But whatever seeds were planted, no matter what, those moments with Quinn, those times we had, those times with the volunteers, there was something special. That was him, a kid grown up in the lower 9th Ward, teaching college-educated kids in graduate school from Pennsylvania. And he knew more than them. You know, that's something that, like, that will be with him forever. Like, you keep asking me these questions, and I have answers for them, but it's hard to express the underlying part of what it all even means. And it's simply, I mean, it sounds so trite, but it's moments. It's people coming together and people seeing each other just as people. That's it. No, you live in this neighborhood, I live in this neighborhood. No, you're black, I'm white. No, you're a criminal, I'm a work at the bank. Same thing. But the difference is, I want to provide a forum, a place, a spot where people can come together, where people who normally would not mix can be together, enjoying the same thing, smiling together, eating the same food, and realizing there's no difference. There's love and there's us together. All that other stuff just washes away. That's the only problem we have, is this idea of separation. It's the only problem in the whole world. It's not even real.